In a globalized world, we have been told that, you know, when the world opens up, you know, the farmers in the south, in the developing countries, are going to gain immensely because of the competition, because they have the cheap producers, and they will be able to compete globally more efficiently. When this debate was going on at the peak of the discussions of WTO, I tried to figure out how would a farmer in India, for that matter, compete with a farmer in America. But then I realized the competition would not be valid. The better competition would be how a farmer in India would compete with a cow in America. And when I wrote a piece on the comparing a cow in the western part of the world with a farmer in the developing world, I never realized it would hit the sensibilities of economists all over. And then I now find that, you know, the Human Development Report, the World Development Report, they all now try to equate the cows with the subsidies. If you rear a cow in America or Europe or in the western part of the world, each cow requires a fan, it requires a tube light, it requires shower, it requires centrally heated conditions. All this is luxury to farmers in developing world. Each cow, the kind of feed that goes to feed a cow, each cow requires about 8 to 10 hectares of land. In my country, the average land holding size is 1.3 hectares in which 5 members of a family plus 2 cattle survive on an average. Each cow, when it is being milked, has to put its head in the feed bin. And now I realize the cows in the dairy farms have a computer chip on their neck. So when they put their head in the bin, the computer chip matches with the chip on the wall. And it tells exactly what is the body weight of the animal, how much protein it requires, how much food it requires. In fact, cow is the most secure food, most secure animal on this planet. We have 320 million people in India going to bed hungry, or 1 billion people globally going to bed hungry, whereas the cows are all very well fed. The inequalities don't end here. If you look at the amount of subsidies the cow get, you know, my estimate was $2.7 per day was the subsidy in Europe alone. And in Japan, it was about $8 a day. And if you compare these subsidies, all subsidies put together, all cows in the western part of the world can travel business class along the globe. That's the amount of subsidies that the cows get in the western part of the world. And the amount of the average income of a farmer in India is about $40 a month. Now, comparing cows with the farmers in the developing part of the world, I think would explain to you the inequalities that prevail and the kind of agriculture that differentiates between the West and the South. This is happening at a time when we are being told globalized world is what is the future for ensuring food security of the world. At the same time, I remember some 20 years back, 18 to be exact, the World Bank told us that the number of people in the next 20 years, this was in 1996, they told us that the number of people who will be migrating from the rural areas to the urban areas in India by the year 2015, which is now around the corner, is going to be twice the combined population of UK, France, and Germany. The combined population of UK, France, and Germany is 200 million, is 20 million, no, 200 million. And they had predicted that 20 years later, 2015, 400 million people would have migrated from the rural to the urban areas in India. Now, I thought that was a warning. But to my utter surprise, when I looked at these subsequent world development reports, I thought they were actually trying to tell us that we must move this kind of population into the urban areas. Now, together with India and China, if you put together, roughly about 800 million people are going to migrate by the year 2015 to the urban areas. These are not the climate refugees. I call them the agriculture refugees. These agriculture refugees are moving on, and because the government is facilitating the process of taking them out of agriculture and moving them into the urban centers. Now, this also brings up the question, how effective the food system would be in the days to come. And under given this scenario, where is the world moving up? How effective localization could be perhaps an answer to what is happening globally? The province that I come from in India is called Punjab. Punjab is in the northwestern part of India. This is the food bowl of the country. We rave and we applaud what has been done in Punjab, but the underbelly, the dark underbelly, is always hidden. And in Punjab, it has now become the cancer belt of India. You know, the highest number of cancer deaths taking place is in Punjab. primarily because of the intensive farming model of agriculture, too much of chemical pesticides, too much of chemical fertilizers. It has now brought in a stage that every day two farmers commit suicide in Punjab, which is the frontline agriculture state of India. And about 19 people die every day from cancer. In fact, such is the situation that there is a train which moves from the cotton belt of Punjab into Rajasthan, the wonderful land as Manish depicted. And there's a train which moves. It is, of course, numbered like all other trains, but it's popularly called as cancer train because it moves people who are patients of from cancer, you know, because of the agriculture labor, agriculture farmers who have been using too much of pesticides. And these are the people who travel every day to Rajasthan to get treatment, and that train is popularly called as cancer train. In fact, now we have the jeeps also. You know, the industry develops along all these diseases. So now we have the jeeps also moving in. So these are the cancer jeeps which take patients every day to Rajasthan. Now this kind of situation tells us that that on one hand, we have been told that when the global environment, in a global environment, you know, you're going to be more competitive, you're going to be more economically viable. On the other hand, the realities somehow are kept hidden. In the last 16 years or so, in a country which is famed for the Green Revolution, 290,000 farmers have committed suicide. Every hour, two farmers die somewhere in India. On top of it, 40% farmers, given a survey done by the government of India, have expressed the desire to quit agriculture if given a choice. So which means there is a terrible, terrible agrarian crisis prevailing, and this is the aftermath of what is called as the Green Revolution. And in most of the suicides that are happening in our country are in the areas where we have intensive farming model or the Green Revolution operating. So there's something terribly going wrong with the way we have been growing food, we have been managing our food. But where is the answer then if this is not the way forward? You know, somehow there is, in a country like India, we have a 1,000 mutinies or a million mutinies where people are struggling, people are trying to build up a new kind of alternative agriculture. But then we are always dismissed by, you know, by the apologist who always says, oh, this is okay in a village, it's okay, you know, to do this in one farm or two farms, but you have to feed the country. And when we talk of feeding the country, last 15 or 16 years in India, we have had a surplus. You will be surprised, ladies and gentlemen, that's how the food economy works. On one hand, we have a huge surplus year after year, food surplus. On the other hand, we have about 320 million people who go to bed hungry every night. And I have never figured out why are the economists telling us to export food when people are dying of hunger or people living in hunger. But that's the kind of economics that works. That's what the growth economics is all about. That's what leads to GDP, as Helena talked about yesterday. 60 million tons is the surplus right now. What is 60 million tons? Not many of us can figure out. Let me present it to you. Present it to you how it looks like, or what it would do in terms of in the realities. If you keep one bag of grain, which is 100 kilos, over another bag of grain, over another bag of grain, over another bag of grain, and you were to stack your 60 million tons like this, you could actually walk up to the moon and come back. Now that's the quantity of food lying in India, and yet 320 million people go to bed hungry. This is because we have a centralized system of food cultivation where we ask people to go in for commodity cultivation, and then we move those commodities to a centralized place, and then we distribute to the poor. I think this is an outlandish way of feeding the hungry or ensuring food security for the world. Now, where do we have to move out of these structures and system? I think there are lots of, as I said, mutinies happening in the country where people have demonstrated collectively, but then there has always been this question, and I think now we have an answer to that also. It started from a village in Andhra Pradesh. Andhra Pradesh is a province in the south of India. It started from a village about 7-8 years back, Panukula, in a district Khammam, one of these districts. That village elders decided one day that they had enough of this intensive farming system. When people are dying, people are committing suicide, the environment has gone from bad to worse, so they decided to stop using chemical pesticides. And then everyone said, oh, you will be down in dumps if you do this, your production is going to fall and so on and so forth. But somehow the village elders struck on to their position. You will be surprised to know, ladies and gentlemen, today 3.5 million acres in Andhra Pradesh is being cultivated without chemical pesticides. This, in my understanding, is the world's largest area under sustainable farming anywhere in the world. And I think it's the world's biggest model for what ecological agriculture would mean. Eventually, halfway down, 6-7 years later, out of the 6-7 years, farmers also stopped using chemical fertilizers. First, they stopped using chemical pesticides, then they stopped using chemical fertilizers. And as people would be warning them, you know, your production is going down, it happened on the contrary, production started rising. The environment became much clean. The insect attack went down very drastically. The environment became clean, which means the health expenses came down for the farmers. And today we have a different kind of food security in that particular belt, you know, in this massive area of 3.5 million acres. Eventually the government actually adopted that region. And today now they have a program of, in the next 2 years, they want to take it to 10 million acres without chemical fertilizer and chemical pesticides. The only area in the country where the use of pesticides has come down is Andhra Pradesh now. It clearly signifies that it has worked. And this feeling that, you know, if you move away from intensive farming system, you're going to be economically unviable and also, you know, not be able to ensure food security has completely been turned upside down. And this region has shown. But the tragedy is nobody wants to talk about it. The mainline media doesn't talk about it. The agriculture scientists do not want to talk about it. The policymakers do not talk about it because the GDP doesn't grow. So the entire emphasis is because the more fertilizer you sell, the more pesticides you sell, the more sick you become, the more the GDP grows. But in this particular case, it's not happening. It's not happening because the sales of fertilizer, pesticides all have dipped. But this is not the only place. In neighboring Chhattisgarh, which is another terrorist-affected region of this country, they've gone into what is called as local production, local procurement, and local distribution. Now, that system of food security has now become another model for the country because now the country is wanting to shift to that particular pattern where we have gone into, instead of centralizing the food procurement and food security paradigm, we have moved away to localizing it to a state level. And I think that is working wonders. And now many, many states are trying to adopt that. This comes at a time when the individual efforts across the country is also taking place. But still, at a time when there is a bulldozer operating which tries to bring in the policies of first Green Revolution and then second Green Revolution, at the same time there are efforts, small efforts being happening at other places. There is another bigger movement happening in India, which is the spiritual movement. One of the spiritual leaders in India, he called me up one day and said, whatever you talk about, why can't we demonstrate to the people and then let us take it as a parallel movement in this country? I thought that was a very good idea. So at Haridwar, we laid out a research station where we are trying to now completely demonstrate what chemical-free agriculture can be. People can come, get training, and also see which model they can form. So we invited best farmers across the country to come and showcase their work. It has now happened. It is now visible. In fact, in the last season, I tried to grow 28 medicinal rices. You know, these rices are all forgotten. You know, these are the rices which were existing in our country. So 28 medicinal rices, rice not many know have medicinal properties. And these are the crops or varieties which disappeared the first time when the high yielding varieties come in. So we try to bring them back into our system. And I will be glad to know, 2 years of my research has given me two varieties. And I think they're very important. One is for controlling diabetes, and the other one for hypertension. So the moment we are ready with it, we're going to come commercially on this to give you a rice variety which if you eat regularly can ensure you to not to get into the trap of diabetes and so on. Now what I'm trying to say is in a few months from now, we're going to give a call to the nation because these spiritual leaders have a huge following. They are in fact like a parallel government. And we believe that we have to upscale the kind of localization efforts that we are doing. So with this hope that in a few months from now, we will give a call for the country to go chemical free, which means we're taking back to the roots in the sense that you try to build up now village republics where you do not have to be, where you have control over your food resources, the kind of food you grow and what you want to grow. I think that is the way forward in a country or in a globalized economy where we believe that the corporates have to produce food. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.